Dear students, last time we discussed the intracerebellar connections, the junctions between the cells of the cerebellar cortex, and now I like to focus on the afferent efferent pathways of the cerebellum, so the connections of the cerebellum. But first I like to highlight a very important schematic drawing which tries to explain the functional correlations between the pyramidal and extrapyramidal systems. The lower motor neurons are those A-alpha and A-gamma motor neurons which directly innervate the extrafusal and intrafusal skeletal muscle fibers. These lower motor neurons can be located either in the spinal cord, ventral horn, or in the brainstem. This figure shows the spinal lower motor neurons. So that's why the major descending pathway which controls the activity of the lower motor neurons is the corticospinal tract, originating from the cortex. These are called upper motor neurons, or upper motor neuron system, and mostly from Brodmann 4, which is the primary somatomotor center. 40% of the fibers approximately originate from there. And we have also the premotor area, Brodmann 6, and even more anterior, Brodmann 8, and even the sensory cortex is participating in the origin of the corticospinal tract. The corticospinal tract terminates mostly through interneurons, that's why I inserted this in bracket, but in primates we have approximately 20-30% of the fibers, especially those which innervate the lateral subdivision of the ventral horn, where we have the somatomotor neurons of the distal precisely innervated muscles. So in this case we have direct connection between the upper and lower motor neurons. In addition to the major control, we have two additional systems. That's why these are called extrapyramidal systems. One is the basal ganglia, the other is the cerebellum, and they converge at two levels, back to the cortex, where we have the origin of the pyramidal tract, via the thalamus. This is the convergence level. V and V are nucleus of the thalamus, and the other is in the brainstem, including the descending extrapyramidal pathways. Here the reticular formation is the common, but we have also some others, what I will mention later. So, why do we need to have an extrapyramidal system in addition to the major control? Because we have some other factors which affect or which have effect on the motor system through the extrapyramidal system, such as the cerebellum. So, for example, the vestibular information from the inner ear to maintain the balance, from the proprioceptors, muscle spindle and the GTO, to be able to control the muscle tone, and we have other environmental cues through the cortex. And if you look at the basal ganglia, just briefly, we have the expression of the emotions on the movements. This is the meaning of this emotional body language. The amplitude of the movements, direction and the decision to move are through the basal ganglia, so that's why we have to modulate the activity of the major control, the pyramidal tract. I mentioned also in the previous lecture the simplified figures about the intracerebellar connections. Again, we have two afferents which are able to excite the Purkinje cells. One is the climbing fiber, which is able directly activate the Purkinje cells on the dendrite tree, and the other afferents through the Mossi fibers, and they through the granular cell, and then the parallel fibers are able to activate the dendrites of the Purkinje cells. Pink means inhibitory, so the axon of the Purkinje cell, which is activated, provides an inhibitory signal to the neurons in the intracerebellar nuclei. The next figure shows the collateral inhibition and the other inhibitory cells as well. So the Mossi fiber through the granular cells and the parallel fibers are able to activate the basket and stellate cells, which then inhibit the purkinje, but as I mentioned yesterday, not the same purkinje, it just shows the basic intercellular connections. The basket and stellate are important for the collateral inhibitions, as I mentioned last time. So, aside the activated zone, we have an inhibition zone. And we have an extra inhibitory cell, the Golgi cell, which protects the system from the overstimulation. So it is able to detect the incoming afferent stimulations, and if it's too much, then it's able to inhibit the transmission between the muscle fiber and the granular cell, as I mentioned last time, in the cerebellar glomerulus. The third shows even more complicated situation. It shows the start points of the different pathways from the cerebellum, from the intracerebellar nuclei. Most of them are stimulatory to the brainstem and the thalamus, but I label the new one, which is not mentioned in textbooks yet. We have a direct output to the inferior liver nucleus from the deep cerebellar nuclei, and this is inhibitory. We mentioned yesterday the major parts of the cerebellum as well, from a functional aspect and also the phylogenetic classification. And now I'd like to show you again these parts and the output signals to the intracerebellar nuclei and the symptoms related to these major parts. As I mentioned yesterday, the most ancient part of the cerebellum is the vestibulocerebellum or archicerebellum. It includes the nodulus and the flocculus, so this part of the cerebellum, we saw this in gross anatomy. This is which receives the vestibular inputs from the inner ear, and we have two options. This is an exemption, we don't need to have a direct connection to the Purkinje cells, to the intracellular nuclei. We have a termination of the Purkinje cell axons from this region to the vestibular nuclei directly, mostly the lateral vestibular nucleus. This is for the balance and the oculomotor function. But we have some other vestibular cerebellar parts which act through the fastigial nucleus, and we have also a different pathway from there to the lateral vestibular nucleus. I will return to this later. The next functionally and also in a phylogenetic classification, the palocerebellum, which includes the medial side of the hemisphere of the cerebellum plus the anterior part of the vermis. From here we have two outputs, partly the fastigial nucleus, partly the interposed nuclei, including the emboliform and the globose nucleus. From here we have descending systems, they belong to the descending extraocular pathways at the end. And the last, and this is the most extended part of the cerebellum, the pontocerebellum or cerebellopontocerebellum, this is which receives the most numerous afferents from diffuse area of the cortex, including a very integrated signaling. And this is also called the neocerebellum. And from here, the Purkinje cell axons are projected to the dentate nucleus. That's why this is the biggest intercellular nucleus. And this goes back to the cortex and it is involved in the planning and programming of the movements. These are the units which belong to these parts. I mentioned the floccolumbar lobe at the bottom, that is the most ancient. The spinous cerebellum is the anterior part of the vermis and the medial side of the hemisphere. And the so-called pontocerebellum is the Golgi, the lateral part of the hemisphere. And here you see the related symptoms. The first case, the vestibular cerebellum lesion, will affect the balance, so we have ataxia and truncal stance and gait ataxia. It is related to the eye movements, so we may have nystagmus, dizziness, vertigo, and vomiting, and it affects also the oculomotor functions. The spinal cerebellum lesion leads to ataxia, mostly related to the lowering, sways and staggers. And the pontocerebellum, which is important for fine-tuned movement. In case of the lesion, we have speech disorder, slurred speech is typical for this, and we are not able to properly estimate the distance when we want to grasp an object. We call dysmetria or hypermetria. And tremor is typical, the intention tremor for this disease. I mean lesion, and can be also related to the muscle tone change. We have a cerebellar homunculus in the cerebellum, so similarly to the motor and sensory cortex, what we studied already, the cerebellum shows also somatotopic localization, even multiple. You don't need to know this, but I wanted to show. And then let's see the afferent pathways, connections of the cerebellum. I will start from the most ancient part, the vestibular cerebellar tracts. The receptors are in inner ear, in the labyrinth, and we have two options. One is when the vestibulocochlear nerve, the number 8 cranial nerve, carries directly the input to the nodule, ipsilaterally. And the other option is when the vestibulocochlear nerve terminates first in three vestibular nuclei with exception of the lateral, so it means the superior, middle, and inferior vestibular nucleus. And then from there we have the vestibular cerebellar tract, which terminates contralaterally in both in the nodules and flocculus. Everybody heard about the spinocerebellar pathways, and they are projected to the so-called spinocerebellum. From the lower limb we have two options. We have the posterior spinocerebellar tract, which starts from the so-called Clark nucleus. This is between C8 and L3 segments, and from here we have a pathway in pink, which is ipsilateral and projected to the spinocerebellum, medial side of the hemisphere of the cerebellum. From the lower end we have another option under L3, which crosses at the level of the start point and then contralaterally ascends and crosses again and projected back to the ipsilateral part of the cerebellum. This is the anterior spinocerebellar tract. So these are from the lower limb. From the upper limb, we have in human, we have only one pathway, the so-called kinocerebellar tract, which starts from the lateral or accessory cuneate nucleus, and this receives the input from the dorsal root ganglia cells from the upper 8 cervical segments, let's say. And this tract, still ipsilaterally, terminates in the spinocerebellum. So if I want to summarize these pathways, all of them will at the end terminate ipsilaterally in the spinocerebellum. In the spinocerebellum. The most abundant afferent would be the pontocerebellar tract, but this receives input from the diffuse area cortex. It is simplified as corticopontine tract, but we know it has several parts, such as frontopontine, temporo-occipitopontine, and so on. And via the pontine nuclei, we have a crossed pathway to the pontocerebellum, the lateral part of the hemisphere. It shows the same, so we go down to the pontine nuclei, simplifying this just from one point, but it's from diffuse area of the cortex. Then it terminates in the neocerebellum, which is the lateral part of the hemisphere. Then the Purkinje cells are projected to dentate nucleus, and from there we have an efferent back to the same side, so we have again a cross pathway to the thalamus. We will see this later as well. So this is the most abundant afferent. And this one is a very special connection between the inferior olivary nucleus and the cerebellum, because this is the only one which terminates with climbing fibers. It shows the special significance of this. And this is also a cross pathway, which is not seen from this figure, but here you see it, that the inferior olivary nucleus would be here, and the pathway crosses the midline as olivocerebellar tract, and this terminates with climbing fibers. And otherwise, it has also connection with the cortex or the red nucleus. I will mention direct connection today as well, which should be a new pathway. And otherwise, backward, we have the same as previously through the dentate nucleus, then thalamus or red nucleus. Here we see a very special pattern. The Purkinje cell axons are projected mostly to the intracerebellar nuclei, and you see the color codes that from which region of the cerebellum, which dentate nucleus receives the, which intracerebellar nucleus receives the input. So, for example, the most developed in human, the lateral part of the cerebellar hemisphere is projected to the dentate nucleus. That's why this will be the biggest nucleus and basically the only one what we are able to see with naked eyes in the gross anatomy practice, but we have others. And if you look at that, these patterns are perpendicular to the longitudinal extension of the fovea, because this is how the fovea are extended, so transversely. So the folium in the vermis continues in the fovea on the hemispheres, in contrast to the inferior nucleus, which is basically perpendicular to this stimulus. And I put here the role of the inferior nucleus. It seems that is important in the motor learning. So when in the experiments the animal does a routine motor task, then the basal ganglia are activated. But when we have an unexpected, you know, obstacle in the travel, then the olivary, the inferior olivary nucleus nerves start to fire. This is what this experiment shows. The Purkinje's dendrites was recorded, and we have simple spikes when the parallel fibers are activated. When we have something unexpected, then we have a complex spike, because this is when the inferior olivary nucleus start to fire. And then when the obstacle is done and the animal returns to the automatic routine task, then we have again simple spikes, but the effect of the inferior nucleus is still present. That's why we are literally rare spikes. And this phenomenon is called long-term depression. This is electrophysiology, so we don't ask it. I just wanted to tell an example for the role of the inferior nucleus. If I want to summarize the afferent pathway of the cerebellum, again, I like to highlight the most ancient, which is the vestibulocerebellar the system and tract. Then I mentioned the spinocerebellar, including the anterior, posterior, and the cerebellar. Here this table shows the trigeminal cerebellar as well, what I haven't mentioned yet, but we have the corresponding proprioceptors on the face as well, related to the mastication muscles especially. In this case, mostly from the spinal trigeminal nucleus, we have a pathway which is called trigeminal cerebellar to the cerebellum. It terminates also ipsilaterally as the other spinocerebellar tracts. We may have some fibers from the main sensory nucleus as well, but this projects mostly to the thalamus, while the dorsal trigeminal lambiscus, because this will be the so-called conscious proprioceptive input from the face. The spinal nucleus is the unconscious. I mentioned the most important, probably in human, the pontocerebellar tract, and then the special one which terminates with climbing fiber, the olivocerebellar. I didn't mention the rostral spinocerebellar, but in human is not proved, especially in those animals are important which are still on four extremities. Then, in this case, we have two pathways from the proprioceptors of the upper limb as well, not only the cerebellar, in that case we have rostral spinocerebellar as well. Here I summarized the effect of the afferent pathways and related vestibulocerebellum. The vestibulocerebellum is for the eye movements and the balance. The spinocerebellum is able to control the muscle tone and coordinates the antagonistic muscles in stance and gait. And the cerebellum is important for the fine-tuned movements. Now I'd like to highlight something. Where are the terminations of the Purkinje cell axons? As I mentioned earlier, almost exclusively in the intracerebellar or deep cerebellar nuclei, we have only one exemption, the lateral vestibular nucleus. So from the vestibular cerebellum, we have some fibers which terminate directly in the lateral vestibular nucleus. Otherwise, the Purkinje cells project to the corresponding intracerebellar nuclei. What do you see here? That the most abundant part, the lateral part of the hemisphere, which is the pontocerebellum, projects to the dentate, the spinocerebellum to the interposed nucleus, including emboliform and globose, and from the rest to the fastigial nucleus. It means the Purkinje cells in all cases. And if I want to describe the efferent connections of the cerebellum, here you see maybe the two most important pathways, the dentato or cerebellothalamic tract, which originates mostly from the dentate nucleus, less extent from the interpost, and it goes up to the thalamus, ventrolateral, maybe ventroanterior nucleus, and from there to the cortex, to Brodmann 4 and maybe Brodmann 6, depends on the textbooks, and this will be responsible for the control of the pyramidal tract at the level of the origin. The other one is the cerebellum or dentato rubral, but in this case mostly originating from the interposed nuclei, so globose and emboliform, and less extent from the dentate. This is seen here. Both are otherwise cross pathways, so that's why if we regard the connection between cerebellum and the cerebral cortex, the efferent was crossed and the afferent, afferent was crossed and efferent also. And the same with the red nucleus, this is a cross pathway to the red nucleus, and from here we have a pathway that I mentioned later, but everybody heard about the rubral spinal tract. The two other efferent pathways of the cerebellum, one is the cerebelloreticular tract, which comes from mostly from the vestigial nucleus, and it gives input to the reticular formation. Reticular formation is a very special neural network through the whole brainstem, basically, which receives from everywhere and sends to everywhere input and output. So this will be the most important, from the reticular formation down to the gamma motor neurons via the reticulospinal tract for the control of the muscle tone. And the cerebellovestibular tract is from the lateral, from the cerebellum to the lateral vestibular nucleus, I mentioned can be direct output from the Purkinje's electrons or to the vestigial nucleus, and this is mostly for the activation of the extensor muscles through the vestibular spinal tract, and this is for the maintenance of the body posture. I'd like to summarize the pathways again, the connections here, the different pathways are seen here. The start point of different pathways, again, I want to highlight from the intracerebellar nuclei, from the dentate nucleus, they are mostly to the thalamus, then up to the cortex, from where otherwise we have the pyramidal tract. And from the interposed nucleus, we go to the red nucleus, from where the rubrospinal tract are descending for activating the flexors. From the vestigial nucleus, we have two targets, reticular formation and the vestibular nucleus. From reticular formation, the reticulospinal, from vestibular nucleus, we have the vestibulospinal tract, the reticulospinal for muscle tone, the vestibulospinal for the extensor activation. New pathway, what I want to label in this figure is this. So the inferior nucleus seems to have a direct input from the intracerebellar nuclei, and I think it's a logic data because the inferior nucleus has a very special role in the function, in the control of the cerebellar actions. Otherwise, this is the only one which terminates with climbing fiber, I mentioned earlier. This is the same, but a simplified manner of the connections, the different pathways. I don't want to recap this. And this is the same as a kind of summary for the, all the connections with the cerebellum, partly afferent, partly efferent pathways. And this is rather from physiology, explaining some special findings and symptoms in case of lesions. I'd like to highlight here the cerebellum, the intracerebellar nuclei, which activate the vestibular nuclei in the brainstem, so these are excitatory connections from the fastigial nucleus especially. And this descending pathway, the vestibular spinal tract, is able to activate the extensor alpha motor neurons, which then act to the extrafusal fibers of the extensor muscles. The antagonistic pathways are the corticospinal and the rubrospinal tract, which activate the flexor alpha motor neurons. This is another muscle group, antagonistic muscle group compared to the extensor. And I like to highlight the role of the reticulospinal tract fibers as well, depending from where they originate, I mentioned in the seminar. But they activate mostly the gamma motor neurons of the extensors. So this is for the set of the muscle tone. And we mentioned the stretch reflex also for this purpose. I don't want to look at this now. But look at these two lesion sites. If we have lesion at level A, this is called decerebrate rigidity. When we don't have cortex and we don't have red nucleus, I mean detached from the rest of the nerve cells. And this way the only one which is still active is the vestibulospinal tract. And this activates the extensors. That's why the patient will be in the rigidity of the extensor muscles in the four extremities like this. But if we have lesion a little bit above the red nucleus, this is called decorticate rigidity when the cortex is gone, but the red nucleus and this way the rubrospinal tract is active, then the patient has in this position the upper limb are in flexion and the lower limbs are in extension. So this is how we can explain this phenomenon. This is mostly in physiology, as I told you, but we know the anatomical background of this. The function of the cerebellum is mentioned here again. I don't want to recapitulate this statement. You can find these things in the previous slides as well. And this shows macroscopically the connection of the cerebellum with the parts of the brainstem. We studied three pairs of cerebellar peduncles. The superior cerebral peduncle connects the mesencephalon with the cerebellum. The biggest one, the middle cerebral peduncle, connects the pons with the cerebellum, and the inferior cerebellar peduncle connects the medulla oblongata with the cerebellum. We studied this in gross anatomy earlier. And I fill now these cerebral peduncles with pathways. The superior cerebral peduncle shows only or almost exclusively different pathways. Dentate to thalamic, dentate to rubral, cerebral reticular, cerebral vestibular, so those four what I mentioned, and the new one is also added, the cerebral olivary tract. And one afferent is found here, the anterior or ventral spinocerebellar tract. The middle, which is the biggest, is almost exclusively contains one type, the pontocerebellar tract. This is which provides the connection between the cerebral cortex and the cerebellar cortex, showing the significance of this connection, because 90% of the fibers will be this. And the rest of the pathways are in the inferior cerebral peduncle, so basically almost all the afferents are in this, with the exception of these two. And I listed here, and regarding different pathways, the last two, I mean cerebral reticular and cerebral vestibular, can be present partly in the inferior cerebral peduncle as well. It summarizes the lesions and the symptoms. The vestibular cerebellum is important for the equilibrium and the eye movements. That's why we have loss of balance and oculomotor disturbances, including nystagmus. In case of the spinal cerebellum, which is important for the muscle tone and antagonistic muscle regulation, the lesion leads to ataxia of Stenson gait and tendency to fall to the side of the lesion. And the cerebral or ponto cerebellum is important for the fine-tuned movements. If we have lesion in this, it is related to special intention tremor, dysmetria. I mentioned the decreased muscle tone is hypotonia and hyperreflexia also, and a slurred speech called dysarthria. This is the summary about the efferent pathways. The first four are found in all the textbooks. This is a new one, a direct output from the cerebellar nuclei to the inferolivary nucleus. It's a contralateral and it's inhibitory otherwise. So I mentioned the first four earlier. And I added the new one to this because it seems it's a very important microcircuit between the Purkinje cells, the dentate nuclei, I mean the intracerebral nuclei in general, and the inferolivary nuclei. And because this is which terminates exclusively with climbing fibers. and the spontaneous oscillation of the inferior limbic nuclei or nerve cells in the nucleus might coordinate the cerebellum activity, and this is important for timing and learning, motor, sensory and cognitive tasks. At the end, I want to show you this very special and relatively rare case, because this was the ninth case, the total cerebellar agenesis, when somebody was born without cerebellum. You see, it's an empty space where the cerebellum should be. And of course, it's not surprising that this patient started to speak much later, and still she has slurred speech and started to walk much later, and still she needs assistance and support to walk. But in spite of this, otherwise she got married and has a daughter without any problem in her pregnancy. And the last picture, otherwise this phenomenon is due to mutation of several genes, so even 30 genes can be included in this. And this relatively surprising, relatively good outcome of this disease is this explanation behind, that the two extrapyramidal systems have two convergence sites. One is the thalamus, because both will lead to the same nucleus of the thalamus, ventral anterior or ventral lateral nucleus of the thalamus, and then they together are able to act on the start points of the corticospinal tract, pyramidal system, or the thalamocortical tract. And the other is the descending convergence point at the level of the interneurons through the brainstem, and we have partly the same descending pathways at the end. The reticulospinal tract is the common for those. So basically, when one of them is missing, in this case the cerebellum was missing, it was a long-term process, because it was an inherited problem, congenital mutation. That's why it was enough time for the basal ganglia to compensate the missing action of the cerebellum. Thank you very much for your attention.